The subject of our discussion is different. Whether it is possible to build high-tech industry here in the Far East. And this is why we're all here. And this is why we have invited so many participants, so many speakers. So I would like to say that I would like to find the answer to this question. I'll briefly introduce all the speakers. Let's start with Alexander Abramov from Evraz Group, one of the key industrial holdings in the country. And from my standpoint, it is important to know that in all Evraz projects, are focused on industrial things, which entails a focus on high-tech industry as well. This is an important point. I would like to introduce Alexander Korneychuk, who is also present here. So we have already set the context for our discussion. And within this context, the person who I have just introduced to you, Alexander Vladimirovich, has already done what he could. He's the general director of Mazda Solars, and his company appeared here whilst it was just making first steps towards establishing its own manufacturing capacity here. They have been working here for 5 or 6 years already, and they have been directly involved into building high-tech manufacturing capacity here in the Far East. Alexander Korneychuk will help us understand how realistic is the perspective and which issues and which challenges he had to deal with on the way to success. Alexei Chugunkov will also participate in our discussion. He's got vast investing experience. He's currently the head of the Foundation for Development of Far East. It will be interesting to know which financial capabilities does the foundation possess in order to foster implementation of high-tech projects. We have another guest, Mr. Sun Jinpeng, the president of Samsung Electronics. I don't think that I will have to tell you in detail what Samsung means and what this company is about. But if the latest statistics figures are correct, Samsung Electronics delivered over $10 billion in sales last year. And the company operates in more than 70 countries all over the globe. So these are the speakers that we have. And I would like to ask you, Alexander, the first question. So your company operates in the Far Eastern region. I mean, you're physically present here, and your company is also here, and you're quite active, and you operate in various fields, and you have a geographically diversified company. So what does Far East mean for you, and what meaning does it have for your business? Well, traditionally, this is a transportation corridor that provides us access to Asian markets, but there is another component to it. I think that we are witnessing how mining industry is getting more and more developed in the on this territory. I think we are in the very beginning of its development, and I think that finally major mining companies will move from the Urals area and Siberia over to the Far East. So this is the right place to be. And if we talk about innovation, well, I would say that we are not trying to invent anything. We are looking at the market. We're trying to find natural niches in the market, and we take up these niches. So if we take innovation in the broader sense of this word, then to me, innovation is not only about manufacturing highest added value product, but in the context of the Far East, it is extremely important for us to forecast the situation and shape the situation correctly. So when we have When we have high returns on capital, which are determined by innovation, we invest. So all our efforts should focus on trying to get return on investment which is higher than average for the country. For a number of reasons, we have some competitive advantage here. And it is important to mention this. And not only in the context of Far East, we quite seldom we talk about things like NPV or IRR. So we do not mention these concepts at these large forums. And we lose to our international competitors because of this IRR and NPVs. We can either deliver high IRR or not. If we don't, we'll lose. And talking about Far East, we have an example of a developing territory which has a developing mining industry. And this mining industry is located pretty close to the giant markets, which keep growing at a very high pace. And I think nobody wants to negate the fact that these markets will keep growing. I'm missing one thing from your comment. So what are these highly profitable businesses? Anatoly, you mentioned high profits and businesses, and I'm telling you the following thing. And I'm actually calling for you to stop talking about high-tech industries. Let's talk about it in a different context. We are a nation who would like to ensure priority development of this territory. So if we invest, we need to get higher returns per invested ruble as compared to our competitors who are operating in neighboring territories. And it has definite, and it definitely needs to be higher than the returns that we're getting in the central part of Russia. I think what you produce, it has secondary meaning. We are quite a poor country with relatively low level of internal investment. And this is the thing that we inherited from the previous times, because we worked alongside the paradigm when we neglected this internal profitability and internal returns. We were very good in calculating returns for the money which was spent by the state and paid a lot of attention to secondary things, which are quite catchy. But attention to these secondary things brought us to the situation we are in at the moment. And whilst we're here in the Far East, I've tried to take a look what are these projects that we can participate in, and what are these projects which can assure our focus on innovation. It doesn't matter whether we produce iPhones or we produce high-quality timber products. We have a lot of bioresources here in this territory. Traditionally, when we talk about bioresources, we normally think of fish. We cannot start producing biological additives, but this is a very profitable business, by the way. But we cannot leap to the final stage before we learn how to properly process fish and other sea products. Before we learn how to properly process it, cook it, and sell it. But let's not talk about it in detail right now. But finally, we will realize that access to these markets, which interest us greatly, and we want to work on these markets in order to ensure our profitability. And this work will be exercised in the form of joint ventures. And to establish joint ventures, we need to break the distrust that is currently in place between us and our partners. Chinese People's Republic often used this statement. Westerners and Americans started operating in China in the form of joint ventures, and we were very skeptical about Chinese car building industry. And now, in 20 years from now, China is in a position to China will be in a position to build highly innovative cars. We mentioned timber and forest industry quite frequently here, and mentioned other biological resources. These products can be profitably used in other industries. But you can only you will only get access to these industries only after you resolve a number of issues. When you know how to utilize the waste which is being generated by timber industry. So it is fundamentally important to stop saying that, hey, we are planning to produce high-tech and high-profitable products. We need to ensure that we work profitably. That's what we've got to focus on. If we invest 1 trillion rubles in a project, so that's a great thing that we can talk about. But I've never heard anybody mentioning the internal rate of return for this project.
So is this a 2% annually, 3% annually, 5%? So we are, if you want to get ahead of them, we're doing a good job. If not, then we need to do something about it. We don't know how to use our money. I understand what you're saying. I'm not sure. Marginality of business, of course, it is its basis. But if we remove this diplomatic layer from it, what I hear there is a pessimistic note. This is what I heard from you. Maybe I'm wrong on this, but high marginality is important, but project which are both innovative and highly marginal in Far East, we don't see them here. Maybe processing capacities are not in place, or maybe there are some other reasons for that, but the estimate, a moderate estimate, that's what we heard. I think it's quite pessimistic. Of course, you're entitled to have this perspective, but I would be interested to hear from Alexander Kornichuk, who, as was stated, from 2009, he came here with Solar's company, and we know that over this time they created here real automotive production. And from what I know, you signed agreement to build a plant to produce engines, and engines in automotive industry are one of the most complicated item to produce. So my question for you is, I remember when in 2008 and 2009 it all got started, I remember that many serious people, I'm sorry for using these strong words, they said, like, he went crazy, it's impossible. You cannot do it in Far East, it will not work. So my question to you is, so what barriers did you have to overcome, and what is the result? Thank you, Anatoly Borisovich, for the opportunity to speak on this topic. So what barriers or things we had to overcome until 2009? From my life, I have two lives until 2009, and now it's my second life. That was a previous life I had. Like in Buddhism, they have 9 lives. So I have, this is my second life now. I don't know where it is located in terms of, if you have 9 lives, where it is on that scale, but it's not the same life in any case. I wanted to share a few words, not responding to your question, but dealing with the previous question of yours. You know, one time we needed to understand, just to figure it out for ourselves, what Far East is all about from the standpoint of logistics, global logistic flows, not Russian ones, but globally. And from the standpoint of global flows And we didn't have our own competencies. For a long time, we selected a company that knew about that area. We hired one company from Germany, a great company, in fact. And people who came to us, they were fantastic professionals. And they were sharing things with us about logistics. But I had a different conclusion about it, though. It was this. They gave us examples of different cities in different countries. That's about constructions, about APEC and marginality, internal rate of return. If the state, and many states do that, and if the state develops infrastructure, if they invest in infrastructure, so that city, that place, within 7 to 8 years will begin to develop. It will start attracting best human resources, new project, new ideas. And if infrastructure is not in place, that will never happen. And they gave us examples of how of Korean cities in Africa, in Latin America, and those are all historic facts. So personally, I think that we should invest in infrastructure. The government should do it because business is not able to develop infrastructure. Infrastructure is a wealth for all of the nation, and we all use it. Now, a few words about our project. In 2009, was there something in Far East and specifically in Vladivostok, so we could look at it and say, like, wow, this is a cool place, we want to be there? No, there was nothing like that here at that time. Really nothing. As an example, you know, I like this response. How can make a difficult project successful? It's easy. You just need to, there is no secret. You need to have detailed preparation, great people, and it takes a lot of work, that's it. But to put it more seriously, when we came here for the first time, we had nothing. We really had nothing. The first thing we did, we built a training center. That was the first step. So let me tell you this honestly, without hiding any truth, sorry for being so straightforward. But those competencies that we needed, nobody had them here. They were non-existent. Now they have them, but they were not around at the time. So biologically grow them. We didn't have teachers to train those competencies. So the first step was 283 people flew here with me. They flew from the European Russia. Yep. They were all Russian citizens. They came from European parts of Russia, so to speak. They were selected purposefully. It was very headhunting. They were rigidly selected. Best people from the Russian Federation. Maybe it sounds boastful, but it was true. Sergey Banov, he's a logistics specialist. He's number one in Russia. And nobody knows some things better than he does. And to talk to them and to come in here, I spent a month talking to his wife because he was all for coming here, but his wife was not. So we brought those 283 people here. And then there were two conditions. Can you leave this place? Yes, you can go back, but only 6 months later. And then when two local people are trained to, but only if two, and the second condition is like when two local people are trained to the same level. So 6 months later, nobody left. And 9 months later, some people started leaving. But 41 families moved here. So the first problem and the first solution, competency of people, workforce. I cannot judge about other industries. I'm competent in the industry that requires a lot of material flows. Those competences should be learned if you want to do something in Far East. So number one, you need to decide where you will train your people. On top of that, Even though many will not forgive me the statements, but I will say it anyways. Find teachers, trainers, they'll be educating your people, and probably you'll need to bring trainers and teachers as well, because what most educational institutions teach here was fine 20 years ago, so that's really obsolete. So you need, so trainers are a big issue. So it's mentally, it's not easy. When you come to local teachers, trainers, and you tell them, you don't know what to teach, and you're teaching the wrong thing. It's very difficult to say that. It's very painful, but it's true. And as a solution for authorities, if the authorities were focusing on and spending more funds on attracting best people in every applied area to train students here, that would be a great solution. Second thing, another significant thing, there's another interesting statement that I like. There are no unreachable goals. There are mistakes in planning. You can achieve whatever you want. And if you do not achieve something, that means that either you lacked resources, or maybe there was something wrong with your planning, something wrong in the sequence of your actions, etc. So any goal can be attainable. I'm a Russian citizen. In my country, planning competencies are very rare, unfortunately, and you cannot teach them. You cannot teach them in this university either, because people who have those competencies are very few. Maybe I can count them all on with the fingers of my hand. Those people who really know how to decompose events. I stick to the plan. If they bring me a plan of an event, if it's less than 500 lines, it means it's a nonsensical plan. But if it has a couple of thousand lines, okay, I respect that work. That means they really worked on it. But if they have five lines, it's their plan. I feel like there's nothing to discuss there. That means people never really thought about the subject matter, because plan cannot be that short. Because we have a complicated life, and to have something happening, five steps may not be enough. So the second topic is planning. If you decide to come not only to far region, to far eastern region, it can be any locality, it can be any project, you need to seriously think about competencies, planning competencies. Where do you get them? How do you develop them? Why did we come here? Because for any production with a large flow of materials, and automotive industry is a type of manufacturing, maybe it sounds excessive, it's not a high-tech industry. Automotive industry is a logistical industry. So who knows logistics the best? They are the best automakers. Toyota, in the end of 50s, Tichiona developed systems we all know about that Americans used in Walmart, and there were their colleagues, Lean Manufacturing, Toyota Production System, and others. So they come up with those concepts back in the 50s, how to organize logistics, how to manage material flows. So they were the best for decades, and they produced great cars, and they don't need to have the largest budget. So we are here because of logistics, because our production, because 22 meters to the port and 7 meters to the railroad. So our flows had an impact in selecting this place. So we wanted to have shortest distances. That's why. So the first project was implemented over 18 months. So it turns out that the number one, it's a people, workforce. The second is planning. And third, logistical organization. Exactly right. If you look at what is in place today already, so Mazda Solars, what does it look like today? So speaking of people, so let me respond following the same sequence. Okay, workforce, people, personnel. So today, our partner, and I have a lot of respect for our partner, I really think it's a great company. Our partner has only two people at the plant. It's a CFO and my deputy. That's it. All the other key positions, quality, logistics, production, synchronization of manufacturing, planning, all of that, services, process engineers, it's all local people, no foreigners. Like for those 41 families, they're not local people, but all the other people are local. This is what Mazda Solars. This is what Mazda Solars look. This is what Mazda Solars look like today. And I was deeply impressed by people in Vladivostok. I had a chance to launch to commission plants in different regions, but this region is different from others because people here are willing to learn, like nowhere else in our country. So they're like a sponge. Logistics director who works with us now, he was hired as a logistics engineer. In a year and a half, he became a director. He learned all the things. That was fantastic. So, but this statement is valid and applicable to all the other colleagues. So people here are like sponges. They're learning so quick and they really want to learn. And I think this is a great quality. You just need to tell people, this is the way to do it. And they do it the right way. So after 6 years here, if you summarize it, so in my mind, it looks like this. You started with, when it was in terms of people, it was like a desert here, and you ended up with people, with highly competent people. I think that most of my colleagues are real state-of-the-art competency, that is highly qualified people. So if you, when you look back at your 6-year experience here, so was that the right decision back in 2009 to do it in Far East? To tell me honestly. Anatoly Borisovich, it's going to be difficult to respond for all of the company. I can only respond for Solars. For Solars, that was our salvation. In 2009, we, as you all know, you know what happened. Ruble depreciation that was very strong, and as most of the components, they're very sensitive to devaluation, depreciation of the ruble. In 2009, we had two plants which had been constructed, brand new plants with wonderful technologies in the Елабуга and in Набережные Челны. And then volumes fell so much, and we had great debt on our hands. But so that was not the best time for such serious capexes. But shareholders had the courage to start a new project in those conditions and believe that expansion was possible, even though in 2010. The volumes were restored and investment started a year and a half later. Mr. Kornichuk instilled some optimism and balanced out the pessimism which we heard from Alexander. But these are our internal perspectives on the situation. So let's ask our guest president of Samsung Electronics to share an external perspective. So you know the scope of Samsung Electronics. I remember I visited you once And at the entrance to Samsung Electronics, there's a wonderful museum there. And in front of the museum, there's this golden plate where it says of the founder, the words of the founder of the company. Maybe it's not a literate citation, but in the middle of the 60s, the idea was the most important thing is properly to set strategic priorities for a medium-sized company which has competencies but doesn't have material resources and natural resources, and having said those resources, to focus on their implementation. So for Korea, electronics was such priority. It was stated in back in the 60s, I think. Correct me if I misinterpreted this statement, but, and we all know that Samsung Electronics is like these days. So what does Russia mean for Samsung Electronics? What is your business strategy in our country?
Fifth year since we started our operation in Russia. So now our annual revenue in Russia is about $5 billion.
$5 billion?
Yes. And we invested about $250 million in the factory in Kaluga, producing TVs, computer monitors, and washing machines. Our local employees about 2,500 people. And out of 2,500, we hire 1,300 people in Kaluga and about 350 people for our R&D facility in Moscow. So Russia is one of the key market for Samsung Electronics. Not only the business volume, but also as a source of high-tech. Russia has a very excellent mathematics capability. So we utilize such a talent to develop softwares for mobile phones and TVs and so on. It's a very important the asset for us. During the last 25 years, we endured difficult times around 2007-2008, caused by a financial crisis. And right now, we are faced with some difficulties caused by currency exchange rate and some slowing down economic situation in Russia. But we'll come up with a good solution to overcome such difficulties, to stay on in the Russia. You know, other than in addition to our business, we are doing some social contribution. Since we started our operation, we have sponsored Bolshoi Theater. We are one of the major sponsors for Bolshoi Theater. And also on the 165th anniversary of Tolstoy's birth, we created Tolstoy Literature Award to encourage the novelists in Russia. By the way, Russian novels are very popular in Korea. So also we can give a good image to people back in our home country. And also we are doing some contribution to reduce a digital divide by supporting smart schools. So we are doing such charity works in Russia to get close Russian the people. We are enjoying a good brand reputation thanks to the Russian people's good appetite for Samsung products. So we are doing the charity works to return such the Russian people's love for our product. So the Apple, Samsung try to be a good corporate citizen here, hiring a lot of local people, producing here to contribute the growth of industrial capability in Russia, and also encouraging the local R&D engineers to develop own technology. And also we are going to transfer our own technologies to such the local good engineers. So once again, we're going to be a good corporate citizen in Russia.
Спасибо, господин Парк. А вот если продолжить вашу мысль.
Thank you very much, but if we continue this idea, and by the way, you mentioned quite spectacular figures indicating the volume of your business in Russia and the number of jobs that you created, but situation in Russia is changing, and is changing quite substantially, and it is likely to have changed for quite a long time. So in talking about the currency exchange rate, I would think that present exchange rate is the new normal rate, so it has to impact your company anyway. So what do you think about it? What is your strategy in Russia? Are you just planning to retain your business in Russia, or are you planning to restructure it? Or possibly you will scale down your business, or on the contrary, embark on new projects? And talking about your plans, do you see any place for Far East on the on your strategic map, or you just consider Russia in general for your further development?
So, as you mentioned, exchange rate situation looks like a new normal, and it's going to last for a while. So we feel we have to come up with some solution to overcome such issues. So under normal circumstances, we have to strengthen our local contents in the Russia to overcome such issues. So now we are in a deep study how we can come up with a solution. In the Far East, we keep our office with about 12 local people, one Korean the manager here. And in this area, we are selling about $50 million. So I was very encouraged by President Putin's speech today. I felt his strong will and passion to develop Far East. So particularly, we need to study the project he described, Freeport project. So in terms of logistics and also free tax, the zone, how we can combine the resources from overseas and also internally from Russia. And then we can come up with some good ideas. But we need to study. So, but clearly it is encouraging. Yes.
Спасибо, спасибо. Ну, мне бы, конечно, хотелось услышать, что в связи.
Thank you very much. But I actually wanted to hear that due to new ruble exchange rate, Samsung Electronics is planning to move its entire manufacturing facilities in Russia and reap vast gains because of this relocation. Well, this was not actually the answer, but now I understand that you want to seriously explore the new opportunities linked to free port of Vladivostok. And if we put this issue in a long-term context, and if we take a look at what happened with Vladivostok during the past 50 years, Vladivostok before was a closed city, and it was a closed port. Then President Yeltsin decreed Vladivostok as an open city. and the citizens of Vladivostok were able to move freely across the country. And I think our current president have made a right decision, and it will affect not only Vladivostok and Vladivostok port, but all ports which are located in this area. And it is important for me that the leader of one of the major electronics company in the world, Samsung Electronics, highlights that he's interested in exploring the feasibility of the projects linked to the ports. So we hope that that will bring some tangible result. So that builds up our optimism, not to a great extent though, but anyway, if we put together these statements from you, Mr. Park, and from Mr. Korniyuk, then we have two against one, and the score is in favor of the optimists rather than the pessimists. And we will keep watching this score. My question is to Mr. Kononov. Dmitry, it's my sincere belief that Sibur is one of the most technologically advanced company in Russia. And I'm not saying this because you're sitting here. And your company epitomizes the idea of high tech. And this is what you do. I was flabbergasted by your research and development activities. But do you see any serious potential to develop your business in the Far Eastern area? I mean, high-tech part of it. Well, after all, you've got oil, you've got gas. Well, go ahead. I mean, petrochemical facilities and can be built here. So what do you think about it? Well, you are very accurate in making your statements and making your forecasts. So there is oil here, and I hope there will be gas. Gazprom has yet to invest a lot to build gas processing facilities, which are required by the gas supply contract with China. That would entail building petrochemical capacity and processing for some byproducts which appear over the course of gas production, production of polymers. We have a research facility in Tomsk, which you just mentioned. And this research facility is testing several options at the moment. Some are quite promising, some are not, and are likely to be dropped. We were the first resident of the technical and economic zones, which were somehow similar to the priority development areas. So we were the first resident to start operating there. But that story belongs to the past now. So we have created our research center in Tomsk. Why Tomsk? Because in Tomsk we had our manufacturing facility as well, and that provided us with an opportunity to test all our technical and engineering ideas. And in terms of petrochemistry and extraction of oil, in Tomsk there is a vast pool of capable people and well-trained people. But we managed to achieve success in innovation, in our innovational activities. But that innovation was about adapting somebody else's technology, and that innovation was about streamlining the processes, and innovation in the purest sense of this word, when you invent something and you implement it. So we tested various opportunities, like, for example, several types of new polymers and how we can tailor the properties of these materials to the need of our particular customers. But then we also stumbled over a couple of things.
So to put together all the ideas, test them, filter them out, and select viable ideas, and their proportion, their share was smaller. So out of 200 ideas, once they were tested, and we started their scaling. Only 5 ideas survived that. And second thing that was difficult to guess for us, when we saw 5 ideas technologically viable and business and viable in terms of business, so with marginality, with profitability, and we can replicate it, and we could replicate it with a different technology. So over the time when we were preparing it, we were able to achieve that, and we generated 6 other ideas that went to the same niche. So we all ended up in a different situation, finally. And the opportunity to get ahead of others, not looking an opportunity for yourself to repeat what has been already done. And there's some others that follow the same way. And they're also smart. They also know how to do it. They can also organize their activities in this way. So speaking of Far East, so we come here with the large industrial project. Wait a minute. Sorry for interrupting. You mentioned something, how to implement new technologies that nobody sees until they come out. And turns out there are 6 other producers that do the same thing. I was present at a discussion where a person from Belgium was speaking when Bill Gates was there. He was criticized and says, like, why do you criticize me? I'm just sharing about activities of our company. But what you told us is just a classical cost-cutting program in all areas. Yeah, so why not? But that means that you're not an innovative company. Time to market is a key thing. It's a different criteria. But considering your scope, the size of your business, you came to the stage where you became a routine business that cuts its costs. So that means you're not an innovative company anymore. So we cross you out from that list. So this is the story that came to my mind. So time to market is really important. It's an issue of survival. Far East, perhaps. So the third type of innovation, when you come up with something on your own and implement it on your own, I don't think we'll see a lot of that. There will be some developments, innovation developments, but it takes a lot of time. It takes a lot of consistent effort, and hardware should be in place, and people should be in place, and it should be scalable, and you need to see what works, what doesn't. And if you multiply your investments and start industrial production, that should be done. But it will take years before you will see the results. And for one area where Far East is a good, provides a good platform, and I've seen those examples, it's organizational managerial innovations. There's a great potential here to make better in daily business processes. And number 2, to adapt technologies. That will be the basis for economic growth here. Do you plan to invest a lot here in Far East? Yes, we do plan to invest. We're moving towards, as an industry, we're buying, accompanying oil and gas products, and we make products for other industries. So we follow oil and gas industry. So far, they are not very much present here, but now they are coming. Gas industry is moving here, and gives us a chance to develop our capacities. In the Mur region, if you look at Gazprom activities, they develop gas fields, they build Power of Siberia pipeline, and they're treating, have a gas treatment facility, and we'll be using, so Kavitka, the Power of Siberia, Chindana, in the Amur region, Skvordino, Svobodny city, which is safely, at a safe distance from Cosmodrome, from the. So I don't want to get all the commercial secrets out of you, but it's billions of dollars in capex, yes, billions of dollars in capex. Alexander Grigorovich, so it's 3-1. 3-1. Let's continue. Let's see what the score will be. I was talking about something else. I want for all of us to think how much we earn also as a nation. If Dmitry said that you do it yourself, you produce it yourself, that's because we don't have long-term money. We are a fairly poor country still. And pessimism, optimism, I have an optimistic outlook. CapEx sizes, billions of dollars and hundreds of millions of dollars we spend here, but it's not related to our topic. We talk about how to ensure innovation development of the region. So I agree with Dmitry that if you come up with it yourself and you implement it yourself, you should not count on it. But advanced, accelerated development of the region, if you create conditions for production and for returns on capital to be higher compared to other places, I think that should be the key. I think Abramov is getting softer. He becomes more and more optimistic. Are you trying to play jokes on me, or are you trying to be serious? You wanted to add something. Come up, you generate an idea, and you implement it. So that's too late to do it now, because the idea should have been generated a long time ago. It's a paradigm that works when you cannot outsource it. There is no environment where you could order it, when you have to do it yourself. So it comes out of lack. No. Maybe you want to have higher profit. You want to develop a new product. You need to have a lot of capital to do it. If you have too much money, if you cannot invest, like Small Business Administration, so you know what, they started giving out money out in the street. $20 billion were given out. You register a company and you get $500,000 if you have some kind of a business plan. Nobody studies that. And nobody checked how many of those companies will be able to potentially repay. So, nobody was checking that. So they don't have their auditors department. So that means the country has accumulated lots of savings at the government level, but we need to get to that stage. So you can come so that at each stage of GDP production would have good returns. And in Far East, you should have even higher returns. This is a very general statement. Of course, we need to look at everything we do through this prism, through this lens. So if you invest in infrastructure here, we need to calculate all of that ahead of time. If we understand, we're all queuing, we all as entrepreneurs, they ask us to invest into infrastructure. But why? Because we calculate internal rate of return and we say it's not sufficient. You have long-term money. Can you get involved? Then this project will generate profits for us, which is acceptable for us. It's a different wording, but the same idea that the government, when the government invests into infrastructure, if we are able to earn a 70% return annually, of course we'll be investing ourselves if we were able to do it. So in America there are so many pipelines. Why is it that way? Because it was profitable to do it. So while Alexander was sharing that, I remembered one story about him. And so I will share that story without his permission. We had a business case with him when I was working in the energy sector. And we were selling one of the assets, a big asset we had. And Abramov came, and he said, I would like to buy that asset. And I said, okay, let's discuss it. What are the terms? I remember the exact figure. And Abramov tells us, you know, that's an interesting asset. I'm willing to pay $2.5 billion US dollars. And for me, that was less than I expected. But I was happy that he announced his starting price. And I said, wonderful. Basically, $3 billion for me would be a good price. He says, you didn't get me. I said, 2.56 billion dollars. Okay, I said 2.9 is okay. Says you didn't get me. 2.56. Said like so. If you are so insistent, okay, 2.7. We can discuss that price. No, you don't get me. I'm telling you, in a straightforward manner, 2.66 billion. Said, look, this is my calculation. This is IR. This is PV. So 2.56 is acceptable, but 2.6 would not be. So I was really impressed, so deeply impressed by this. So that means that whatever Abramov says now, it's not, there's no accident. It's no accident. This is his ideology. His business approach is based on it. We didn't come to an agreement at that time, and it was too expensive for him. So that perspective can exist. But we would like to have a different perspective on this problem, on this topic. I would like to address Alexei. So are there any projects there? Do we have things to discuss here? We talk about innovative development of Far East, whether it's interesting or interesting. Abramov says it should be profitable, but do we have those projects? Anatoly Borisovich, first of all, I would like to thank you for this discussion. It's a high-quality discussion, and strangely enough, I agree with all of the speakers. So the degree of optimism, not either your optimism or not, it's 0 or 1, but are you excited about your business story and about your prospects? I would correlate degrees of processing to get a highly added product and what they feel about working in Far East. Alexander has worked here with processing, degree of processing, which are quite complicated. Delivery of ore from Yakutia of concentrate, it's about distances, about tariffs, and all those difficulties in Far East and of our large territories, they kill any kind of internal rates of return. And Sibur works in processing of gas and oil in petrochemistry, so they go to Irkutsk region in that zone. So they install a methanol plant. So and you need to use a railway to transport it. But Solars is more optimistic because 75 meters to the port, and we know that maritime logistics is very effective. You can put any modern plant on the Cook Islands, and you can bring everything needed in containers. And Samsung is a different story altogether. Over 50% of value added value, it's not physical materials, it's intellectual work and branding and emotions and sensations. So if they have a plant in Kaluga region, I think they could do it also in Yakutia if they only had the chance. So Anatoly, you are right to word it like that. Development of Far East can be only innovative. So from the standpoint of business, it's doesn't mean a lot that so they have great deposits of silver in Yakutia. So when the market was speculative, you could have used it. There was some activity, but now with AIM, activity is down. So people left, but to do business, technological business, even assembly business, it makes sense here because a lot of goes through Amur, and large markets are just next door. And just because we build a modern enterprise, you have different degrees of being state of the art. So without planning, and I disagree with you. So it can be even if you have thousands of lines in your plans, but to build a having built the most contemporary plant in the very close to the markets and having hired smart, intelligent people, there are high chances that it will be successful. And to answer your question about projects, that's exactly how we formulated this question a year ago when the foundation started operating. The main problem was the lack of projects, but it's not really true. It's not a business incubator. We don't have a screenplay. So there are no entrepreneurs, there are no businessmen, there are no businesses. A project is like a novel, but you need to have a novelist, you need to have a writer. So it's a socio-cultural reality, but we have been doing this not for a long time. You were one of the first. You were a referee. You were making the rules of the game. But even in India, it has a complicated geography to do something. It's below us in many ratings, but there are entrepreneurial plans there. There are companies in the third and fourth generation, and they're great consumers of capital. They're interested. They are able to attract shareholder capital, and they're not afraid of those things. They're not afraid of distances or energy tariffs. They feel the market. They know how to sell. They will learn how to produce. They've been doing that for 70 years. And as capital managers, even modest capitals, to follow the hopefully instructions of Vladimir Putin will be fulfilled and will get stronger financially. So we need to think who will be managing our money. Project driver. So we call them locomotives. So something that makes everything move. So we have a problem with those drivers or locomotives. So it's an objective for all of this government. So we have not made heroes of our businessmen, but they should be people everybody admires. They should be heroes. Those who are able to build such plants, they should become heroes. And like with that example of Solars, it's a complicated task, but there are very few examples like the one of Solars. It's an industrial business, and Kaspersky is a well-known businessman who competes successfully globally, and So Kaspersky, if he comes, we would invest in him. He's a brand himself. So in Freeport of Vladivostok, I will do something, and if and you just need $10 million for that, I think many people would be queuing to give money to him. So if we had 1,000 of people like Kaspersky, they need money. They need today's financial system. Is not able to provide necessary financial resources. It's complicated, so you need to apply pressure. And as a state investor, I recall Nikolai Kosygin, a Soviet leader, who had this idea and actually was later used in China, that recipe. So we need to have one Kosygin, we have 1,000 Kaspersky, and we need to have capital for this system. And then Far East would be a wonderful place for business, thanks to the people who are learning so quickly here. And thanks to profitability, we would be very competitive, we'd be able to sell to China, to Korea, to Japan, and we'd be surprised ourselves.
Thank you very much. And since you mentioned Kosygin, regarding gas exploration, aluminium manufacturing, and petrochemical projects, all those projects had proper feasibility studies. They had cheap energy, availability of cheap energy, and they were built in a cluster. So they put together industries which were very energy consuming. I would like to draw your attention to the fact that Alexei has recently published an article elaborating on the fact whether you can build, whether one can build a manufacturing facility in taiga or in the dead of the woods. And I was very much interested to read that article, by the way. We have a number of experts present here in our conference hall. And one of these experts is Vice President of Summa Group, Mr. Winshor, and he is here, please. Summa Group is well known, is renowned as to be a dynamic and young company, and Vladivostok has always been a priority for this company. And Mr. Abramov has rightly pointed out on profitability. Are your Far Eastern projects profitable? If possible, I will speak on behalf of Summa and Summa Group, and I will speak about the project that we currently have underway. One of the areas which we currently explore is the Far Eastern territory, and we work together with FESCO here, and we're also interested in developing one more port. So this territory has certain geographical advantages, and our portfolio companies, which used to invest into us, they're very much interested into utilizing this potential. I'll give you an example to illustrate our way of thinking. We have set up a company in the United States that prepares meat out of soya concentrate, so soya meat. And you can, I remember there were sweets made of soya. No, I think that product is better. And you can hardly tell this artificial meat from the true meat. If I actually ask you to go through a blind test, you will find it difficult to tell soya meat from real meat. However, the raw material for producing artificial meat is not available, even though soya is being grown there. So there is huge market available here. So what is the point in transporting soya beans if you can transport a higher value-added product? So we have a technology for this. There is a special technology that allows for conversion soya beans into concentrate. A kilo of soya can yield you 0.6 kilo of meat after two stages of processing. First, we make concentrate, then we make isolate. Sometimes we buy this isolate from China, which makes our American colleagues to feel nervous. And we are thinking about setting up this manufacturing facility in Zarubino port, where we can reap the benefits of tax breaks and other sorts of economic advantages. We would be able to sell these products to our neighbor, which is currently focused on expanding consumption of proteins. So it is better to produce higher added value products, and we are delighted to see that RusAgro, Russian agricultural business, is embarking on agricultural projects here in the Far East, because that will allow them to save on organizing their logistics. Another approach is to become more vertically integrated, and we're not trying to just sell grain or get involved into grain trade. We try to make products out of it. We have a project in Canada, so we grow agricultural products, and we have become really good in forecasting the amount of revenue that we get per kilo of grown soya or other crops. This subject is interesting for us, and we do believe that in the Far East there are places where this technology, agricultural technology, can be employed, and these projects can yield profits both to our shareholders and our portfolio investors. Thank you very much for your comment. And we're almost running out of time, but still we have one more independent expert who is also present here. This is Andrei Fursenko. I would like to ask you a question, but this question is addressed to you not in your capacity of a presidential aide, but as a person who started working out innovations almost at those times when we didn't know the word innovation. And you are the person who have set up the first structure in Russia which could embark on innovational projects. It was a research facility in St. Petersburg. So tell me, as a professional, not a public servant, but as a professional, developing Far Eastern territory along the lines of innovation, is it a true perspective? Is it realistic? Or it is just a dream? I would like to support Alexander in his statements, and I don't understand why you're picking on him. All he said was we need to be mindful of profits and money. And innovation is about money. It is not about technological solutions. Let's say if you have a solution which can yield profits, call it innovation. If not, then it's just a waste of money. Or call it a game, call it sponsor financing. But you will achieve success only in one case, if you do your sums correctly. And correct me if I'm wrong, but Alexander was calling for making profitable innovations. So come up with an interesting solution. So if you come up with an interesting solution, you will find investors. And looking back into the 90s, I must say that I have never agreed with statements like there is no money available. There are no ideas available. We have, in terms of money, we have more than we can spend. Sometimes we have so much of it that we have to hand it out to businessmen. So there were times when we were providing funds to those who were capable in using them wisely. So, but the higher is the risk, the higher should be potential upsides. As was mentioned by one of my then partners, he said that any venture capitalist and any venture investor is moved forward by two feelings. So one is he's afraid, and another one is that he's very, very tight in terms of money. And once this tightness takes over the fear factor, they start to invest. And I sincerely believe that there are vast investment capabilities in the Far East territory. But another thing is, probably we should not set up microelectronics manufacturing facility in the Far East. This is not the place for it. My stake would be on timber industry, for example, provided proper technologies are used for it. I believe that logistics innovations for Russia are more important today than other things that we traditionally understand when we hear the word innovation.
It must be a tradition, because we used to consider physics to be one of the main sciences. So if there are no innovations in physics, it's okay. But if we talk about food products, we say, oh, it's not innovation. It's just food industry. It's not that important, but in all of the world, the weight of innovations in food industry is much larger compared to microelectronics. I think that the first and foremost to be done in Far East, we need to select areas where those innovations can really take flight. So I think food industries definitely should be there, because as it was, they talked about soy. Why was that the right thing? Because next to us we have a unique market right here. Well, 600 million people just next door, and they'll be lacking food because of the growth. Average income in China is $13,000. So it's not a bowl of rice per day. People want to have better food options. So that means a great food market. So if we add to that real innovative, maybe not, we can skip innovative, but if just we use effective technologies, so high marginality will be guaranteed, because we have a lot of land. The land is okay. In some places it's okay. Climate, by the way, if you organize properly this approach, it's acceptable. And clearly there is a demand, and they have the means to pay for their demand. There are several areas. There's some other areas which can produce similar results by sea resources, by resources and their processes. I think there's a great potential there. Our specialists in biotechnologies, sea biotechnologies in Russia, I'm pretty sure we don't have such specialists. And I think there are very few, even in other countries, but still, they have some interesting. There are some interesting technologies there. I supported some of them when I worked in a different way, on a different job back in Moscow. But there's some limits there as well, because they do it on the go, without proper planning, and also other competencies are required. But nobody comes to second and support them, because they do not trust them as business partners. That's a separate topic. It's quite complicated, and not just you and I, but many present here know that this is an open issue, and we can deal with that. I think the state's role there is even higher. In my own experience, I can tell you that there were instances of success when such scientists who were not businessmen, but they became businessmen. And we have some, we know some of those people together. And there were some other examples when people had great ideas, but they didn't become businessmen. So I go back to where we got started. So if that person understands that innovation is business, and if you're a great scientist, you can still find a common solution. If you think that innovative business, 90% is about his idea, no matter how interesting that idea is, you'd better stay away from such a person. Thank you. Thank you, Andrei Alexandrovich. Dear colleagues, I think we need to summarize the results. I wanted to share a few words from myself. I try to look at this discussion as if to have an internal perspective from it, to get rid of my subjective impressions. The city where we are and the Rusky Island today and 5 years ago. So what was it like? I'm not even saying 15 years ago. They had no water supplies. They had no kind of sewage, energy crisis, capacity, insufficient capacities, no roads, airport. It's all clear with the airport situation. I'm afraid of being excessive in my optimism, perhaps unfounded optimism, but sometimes we do not capture the scale of changes. This, I'm not even talking about this campus. Life is so different from what it was like 15 years ago, even 5 years ago. What we heard today at the forum, priority development territories, profit tax 10%, is a good figure. And if you have innovation, sometimes your profits and social tax of 7%, okay, that's pretty serious. Instead of 30%, Freeport, Vladivostok, sounds quite promising. It can give you something. I may be wrong about this, but once again, I don't want to be overly optimistic, unfounded optimism. But I think that we have this potential the last 25 years here in Vladivostok. Now we see a new foundation here, a new starting point. And it seems to me that the scenario for the next 10 years, I think here in Primorsky region, we will have a serious new processing facilities for oil and gas. What Mr. Konov said, we will have here in Kamchatka, we'll have a true tourist cluster there, and so on and so on. All of that seems to me is not just fantasizing. Whether that new Far East will have a place for serious innovative company, I don't know about that. But I know for sure that today's conversation, with all pros and contras, would have been senseless 5 years ago. And 15 years ago, when I came here to stop a strike which of energy workers that almost became a hunger strike, and they brought, and so that situation and the level of discussion was so different at the time, it seems to me that some seeds for optimisms are in place. So I'm really thankful to you, Mr. Dear Alexander, because you've been quoted so many times today. I would like to thank all other members to panel discussion. I would like to thank Mr. Park for his informative and precise answers. I would like to thank the experts and the audience as well. Even though we had few people here, maybe it's the room is so large, and so it looks like you're few, but still it feels like you are listening to every word pronounced by our participants. So that gives me an additional optimism. Thank you all very much for your participation in this session. Thank you.